Praise God. Welcome to this special edition of God's News Behind the News. Wherever you're tuning in today, you're going to want to just sit there, leave that knob right where it is on that television. Don't try to click it and change it, because for the next 30 minutes or so, I have one of my best friends, one of the greatest preachers and teachers, and God is using this man tremendously. I've done more television shows with this man than anybody else in the world. I want to welcome to our viewers once again my dear friend Perry Stone.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Joe. Always good to be here.
Now, Perry, you know, just before we get into our subject, I've got to just say that Perry just recently celebrated his 50th birthday.
Yes. And you know, the amazing thing happened. My hair was great when I got up one morning. It was just...
Well, that's what I wanted to say.
Change. Notice the difference. Keep that shot.
Yeah,
notice the difference.
See, look,
here's Moses and here's Joshua.
But now, see, what you don't realize is I'm younger than Perry.
Oh, don't tell that now.
See, Perry's 50 and I'm not quite 50 yet. So how does it feel? I haven't asked you yet.
Wonderful. Now, you know what? It's things break down. That's all I'm going to say. You just have to really trust God.
Oh, my. But you look younger.
Thank you. Now that
you've reached 50, you've reached
Thank
a younger
well,
appearance.
He said he'd
Whereas
renew
me,
you like
I still look like the old man. But
we'll help you out.
Perry, 5 years ago, we sat right here and talked about a book that you had just recently released called Unleashing the Beast. And we did a series of broadcasts, this is 5 years ago now, where we dealt with the Islamic connection to the spirit of Antichrist. I believe, honestly, that to my knowledge, that's the first time on a prophecy broadcast nationwide, like this one was, around the world, literally, that two Bible prophecy students, scholars, authors, whatever you want to call us, dealt with the subject. Today, there are millions of viewers watching us that never saw those shows 5 years ago. And I'm leading up to this because now you have re-released the material in a brand new rewritten book.
Yeah,
and of course,
I
read the old one 5 years ago and read this one. There's just a wealth.
You marked
it
up.
Oh, my goodness.
You marked it up.
I worked this thing over.
I sure did.
And when I read the new version of this one that's now being released, and we'll talk more about that in a moment, I said, I got to go in the studio again because it's been 5 years. And the reality is the whole idea of the Antichrist being Muslim, the Islamic connection, and how the Islamic nations, you and I believed 5-6 years ago that it was almost like a missing piece of the puzzle. Would you say it that way? The prophecy teachers that we learned from, the prophecy teachers that mentored us, Islam was not a big piece of the picture.
Well, let me tell you how this started.
Yeah.
This started, it's kind of like been a journey for me to understand this. It started with me going to Israel. If you sit here in the West and you look at prophecy only with Western eyes, the only conclusion you can come to is the common market or the EU is going to produce a man who's going to bring peace, and then all of a sudden the man's going to turn on Israel and take it over, which really never made a lot of sense to me. But based on the fact that Europe basically doesn't like war and doesn't want war and doesn't support wars. I mean, it's very difficult to get France and Germany. And the reason it's difficult to get the European countries is because they've been through war.
Yeah,
I mean, they've had World War I, they've had World War II. Who wants war?
Yeah.
And so when I went to Israel, I heard a Muslim tell me, he said, we believe that there's coming the Mahdi, some say the Mahdi, or we'll just use the English
Mahdi.
Yeah, the Mahdi. And he is going to come at the end of days. He will come with Jesus. They will come to Jerusalem. And this is all an Islamic teaching. And they will tear down the cross and kill the swine. Well, I didn't know what they meant by kill the swine. I've been all over Israel, never saw a pig. Jews don't eat pork and Muslims don't eat pork. He said, no, this is just a terminology for Jewish people.
That's
and I'm thinking, whoa.
Yeah.
Well, it started there, and I didn't think a lot about it at the time until I was in Louisiana, and a girl from Iran heard me preach on Revelation 13. And in Revelation 13, it talks about a beast rising up out of the sea with 7 heads and 10 horns. That's the Antichrist system.
Yes. And we're going to talk about that and explain,
yeah, we'll explain
why
that.
It's 10 and why it's 7 by the time we're done.
Right.
And show that it can't be Europe and it can't be the EU.
Exactly.
It's a revived Roman Empire. But they try to mash that into the EU. Not to interrupt you. Forgive me, Perry.
No, no, because
I know this foundation is important for our viewers.
Yeah, this
to hear
is the foundation. And then I read Revelation chapter 13 about the false prophet. See, there's two distinct individuals. One is a man that's a military leader. One's a man that's a religious leader. And this lamb with two horns, who's a false prophet, has two horns representing the authority over two religions.
Yes.
So I start saying to myself, okay, if I'm in the Middle Eastern area or the Great Sea that Daniel saw, what are the two religions? And predominantly it's, I call it traditional Roman Christianity. Sometimes it's Orthodox, Greek, from the Greek Orthodox, from the Turkish branch or the Russian Orthodox. It's Orthodox Christianity, as they would term it, and it would be Islam. There's no two other religions that would have the equal number of adherents in that part of the world. And then this Persian girl came up to me and she said, have you heard about the Mahdi? And I said, no. So she began to tell me, and I want everybody to hear this because this is how this started for me. She said, in Iran, they believe, there's 98% Shia Muslims, and they believe that when the 11 Sunni Muslims were killed by the Shia, most of them were killed in the country of Iraq, that the son of number 11 was hidden in a well. And that in nobody knew what happened to him. They've never found his burial site. And they believe he is preserved by God till the end of days, and he will emerge in the country of Iraq as they call it the doctrine of the Twelver.
The Twelve.
Now,
the
there's,
12th
been,
Imam.
There's been some famous books and novels written on this theory, but we start teaching this in 1992, Joe. And I remember when I went to the prophecy conference for the first time, boy, it was not received. It was received by the people, but the scholars, and one guy told me, he said, Perry, I believe it like you, but I've written too many books, I can't change them.
That's it.
And I would never say who said that to
me.
I respect the man. But when she said that, she said, you just described in detail the Mahdi, and I said, explain to me why. She says, well, first of all Islam says he will appear riding on a white horse. And in the book of Revelation, which most people identify as the Antichrist, coming forth to conquering, with a crown, a bow with no arrows. They point that out. We assume, though, if you have a bow, you've got arrows somewhere. The Bible doesn't have to say you got arrows or not. But he comes in peace at first, but he conquers through a false peace. And I said, wow. She said, also, you will be beheaded if you don't follow him. Well, there's Revelation 20.
There it is.
I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the word of God, the testimony which they held. Now, here was another interesting point that I found out through my research a little later. There are Islamic quotes that I can give you. In fact, I believe we give them in the book that talks about how they believe that the white horse rider in Revelation is the Mahdi.
That's very important that you
they
understand.
They believe.
Muslims,
yeah.
I want to reiterate,
yeah.
Muslims, because it's a fact, I've documented this well, Muslim scholars themselves
are saying that.
Go to these verses in the book of Revelation
chapter
and
6.
Say, this is the coming Mahdi.
And they
know that the Bible calls him the Antichrist.
Right.
But they see him as their delivering Messiah.
As a good person.
Their man that's going to bring peace and justice. And what's really important, Perry, that you have not said it, is that he's going to convert the world to the Islamic religion.
Right. Now, the other part that I want to share...
in their beliefs.
Yeah, in their beliefs. Now, this is their own belief now. This is the Islamic belief. And I have several quotes on this, which fascinated me. That when the Mahdi comes, he rules for 7 years.
Isn't that interesting?
Now, some will say 10, some say 40, but you can find the quotes where he rules for 7 years.
7 years.
Now, that's important.
It's in the book, by the way.
Yeah, that's important to understand based on Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, where he confirms a covenant with many for 1 week. Now, the Hebrew word week there is not 7 days. There is a word for 7 years. The example of it is with when Jacob was working for his wife, and he got the wrong one, and the dad, Laban, said, fulfill my daughter's week, and he worked 7 years.
7 more years.
And it's the same Hebrew word that's found in Daniel 9:27. Now,
So he's going to be riding a white horse. He's going to behead
years.
Those that don't convert to his religion.
Yeah.
And he's going to rule for
7 years.
All of these are Islamic beliefs. And lo and behold, they line up perfectly
with the predictions of the prophets
of
the Bible.
With what we know about the Antichrist.
Yeah, exactly. And so what I did is I began to do in-depth research in 1992 and 93 on the concept of the Mahdi and who he would be and how he would come. And I also went to Israel, which we have. And let me just add here, I have Jewish and Muslim friends like you do, Joe. Some of the Muslims in Israel are very friendly toward us and respect us if they are simple, just family-loving people, and they respect your preaching. I sit down and talk to them about this, you know.
We have spent many hours together with with wonderful men.
That's right. Who love their families, who want peace.
They're Muslims.
Who are not the crazy.
They're not the radicals.
No, exactly. And so I want to make that clear that when we share this, we are saying that we have to also warn Muslims, not just Americans, not just Europeans, but the Muslim people need to be informed that when they see certain signs occurring, not to be deceived by a man who will set himself up as this final Messiah for them. And this is the reason why we have to go to the prophets. In fact, most of the Muslims that we talk to are very fascinated for me to go to the Bible because they don't know it and show the scriptures. And I've had their eyes get big and they say, we never knew this. Yeah. And there are others that, don't quite put it together yet. But I think that we have to share with them what the prophecies of the Bible teach in a loving way because help them as much as possible. Too.
Absolutely. Perry just took the time to describe how he got on this track a number of years ago. We're going to take a brief break. And when we come back, I want us to go to the main text verses, Perry,
that teach the
teach how this Antichrist spirit is part and parcel with the spirit of Islam today. But let me give you one verse that I can't get away from anymore, and it's the reality of what Jesus says in John 16. And for years I read this verse with a certain thing in my mind, but now I read it with a whole different emphasis, and that is this. He said, "They shall put you out of the synagogues, and yea, the time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he doeth God service."
Whoa.
There's only one religion and one religious system in the earth today that's controlled by a spirit that believes they do God service if they put this other person out of the synagogue, that's a Jewish person, or we could say out of the churches, that's a Christian person, and kill you in the name of God. We're going to take this break because I want our announcer to tell you all about the special offer, this brand new released book, along with my book, The Unveiling of Man of Sin, and several other important items. We're going to come right back, and we're going to build on the foundation that we've laid. Here's our announcer.
Will a coalition of Islamic nations soon form, creating the final kingdom for the Antichrist to emerge? Do Islamic predictions for the end time actually correlate in many ways to what the biblical prophecies declare? In Perry Stone's revised landmark new book, Unleashing the Beast, these questions and many more are answered for you. One chapter in this new book is so controversial that once printed, bookstores refuse to carry it. In addition, Unveiling the Man of Sin, written by Dr. Joe VanKoevering, has become the most talked about book in prophecy circles. In this must-read volume, Joe not only reveals exactly where the Antichrist will emerge from, but he shares the actual name of a man who can fulfill all of the biblical prophecies regarding the Antichrist. And lastly, Joe VanKoevering and Perry Stone have just finished this 90-minute DVD where they answer the many skeptics of how the Islamic world will in fact produce the coming man of sin, the Antichrist himself. Learn who the 12th Imam actually is. Discover why Babylon must rise to world prominence again, and so much more. With this one-of-a-kind new DVD, you can literally sit down with these two scholars and have your prophetic questions answered. All three of these items are now yours for a gift of only $45. Send your gift to God's News, Box 10475, St. Petersburg, Florida, 33733. Or call now, 888-GOD'S-NEWS. That's 888-463-7639. Make that call and start to understand the Islamic beast.
Welcome back to our time of discussion. I'm here with my good friend Perry Stone. We're talking about his book, but this is the book that I wrote, Unveiling the Man of Sin. We released it last year. It's gone around the world. And I have an entire chapter in here devoted to the subject of the spirit of the Antichrist. I contend, and I know Perry contends mm-hmm. with this with me, as you do in your book, that you can't identify the person without first identifying the spirit. Mm-hmm. So, because they're linked together.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So how in the world could the spirit of Antichrist be so clearly what we're about to share with you, and yet the man known mm-hmm. as the Antichrist, as some is taught, is a Jew from the tribe of Dan, or is some European, whatever. Mm-hmm. Anyway, let's deal with it, because this is foundational.
Yeah.
And our critics, by the way, which we're eventually going to get to in the coming weeks, because we now have a whole generation or a whole series mm-hmm. of Bible prophecies, students and scholars that are taking us to task. I've read all their stuff, and I know what they're saying about us, and we'll deal with that. But none of them, Perry, not a one of them, take us to task on this, because they don't have a solid answer to rebut us.
No.
Because we take you to the scriptures, so let's give them to them.
Okay, let me say this. There's four beliefs about the Antichrist. Belief number one is the Antichrist is an evil principle, but not a literal person. Number two, that the Antichrist is a person, but a person of the past. Like the preterists say, it was Nero, it was one of the past emperors, which is incorrect teaching, by the way. Number three, the Antichrist is a system, but not a person. And some people believe it's like the Roman church system, or it's a religious system, and that's how the Reformers taught it. Others believe that the Antichrist is a person with a particular spirit,
right,
who will appear at the end of days, which is what Joe and I believe.
I believe the New Testament teaches that.
Sure. Now, where does it come from? I'm going to give four verses of scripture, and scholars identify that the Apostle John is the one who coined this term we call Antichrist. And here's the four verses that describe to you what the Antichrist is and what the concept of his doctrine is. Little children, it is the last hour, and as you have heard that Antichrist is coming. Even now, many Antichrists have come. By now, we know that it is the last hour. Now, 1 John chapter 2, 22 through 23, who is a liar but he who denies that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist who denies the Father and the Son.
Key verse right there.
That's a key verse. Yep. Whoever denies the Son does not have the Father either. He who acknowledges the Son has the Father also. 1 John 4, 3, every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of the Antichrist.
Yes.
Now, there's ho antichristos. It's very important that you look at that there, because there he identifies the personality of a man, a exact personality, not just a spirit, which you have heard was coming and is now already in the world. Then 2 John 1, 7 and 8, many deceivers are going out into the world who do not confess Jesus Christ as coming in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an antichrist. Now, there's three points I want to make. Number one, the spirit of Antichrist was working in John's day. What is that spirit? It's twofold. Number one, it denies that Jesus has come in the flesh, because there were people that taught that Jesus was just a spirit and that he had no flesh on him. And so that's part of it. But here's the main point. The spirit that denies the relationship of Jesus the Son and God the Father, and denies that Jesus is the Son of God.
He is the Son of God.
When you get those two combinations, you have the spirit of Antichrist. Now, the preterists point out, well, didn't John write and say many Antichrists have already come, so the Antichrist has already come when John wrote that?
Mm-hmm.
And they get their self, they shoot their self in the foot when they do that, because if they say that Nero was the Antichrist, first John was written before Nero ever came.
Mm-hmm.
So if John is saying many Antichrists have already come,
uh-huh,
then they blow themselves in the foot because Nero hadn't come yet.
Yeah.
When they wrote this, of course, we know from the preterist, you can kill preterism by one thing. You can absolutely prove historically the book of Revelation was written in 95 A.D. The preterists believe the book
AD.
Of Revelation was written before the destruction of the temple,
yeah,
and all the prophecies were fulfilled. But that's another subject for later.
Preterism is another subject
for later.
But it does fit in this case, because people are confused about
the
fact that the Antichrist is going to carry a certain doctrine. The Antichrist spirit is very clear.
Yeah.
You have to deny the relationship between the Father and the Son. You have to deny that Jesus was the Son of God, that he was divine.
Yeah.
Now, you and I know there's one religious system on this planet that boldly proclaims that. In fact, it's the main tenet of their doctrine, that is Islam.
Now, see, someone points out, one of our critics will point out, well, Joe and Perry say that in the Islamic religion, that they say that God, Allah, has no son and he's not begotten, but so do the Jews. But wait a minute, let me say something. If I can use this term, the hang-up that religious Jews have is the scripture that says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one." And see, what they, and even Muslims have difficulty with this as well as Jews, the triunity of God.
Right.
When you use the Hebrew word, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one," you take the word one, it's the same word used where Adam and Eve became one. It's the word that is used about a man and woman becoming one flesh. It's one in unity, It's one in same thinking, one
nature
in the same
and
power,
purpose.
Power and purpose.
Exactly.
Right. We do not believe in three gods.
No,
we're not
we
a
do
three
not.
God religion. We
no,
believe
we
there's
not.
One God, but he manifests himself
three
as
persons.
Three persons, which is God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. His
right.
three different manifestations of him
right.
On earth. And so that's the problem.
That's the difference.
Yeah, that's the problem that the Jewish people have and the Muslims, because we do not believe. In fact, in Muhammad's day, because there were people that were worshiping Mary in Muhammad's day, he even taught that the Christians believed in Jesus, the Son, and Mary was the Holy Ghost.
Mary was the Holy Ghost.
And so I don't know, there may have been people teaching that in the 7th century.
Yeah,
I
right.
haven't researched that, but that's totally incorrect teaching
yeah.
for anybody if they did teach that. That is heretical.
Yes.
And so there was some of that going on in his day, and so he was adamant to say there's only one God, which is what the Jews were teaching as well.
Yeah.
And there was a lot of, just to be honest, back in the 7th century, Christian teaching had become very heretical. A lot of heretics were in the church. A lot of teaching was being taught that was totally out of line with Scripture. And thank God now, when the common people have the Bible and we can research the Bible,
right.
we can know what the doctrine is. But getting back to this point, the spirit of Antichrist has always been in the earth, because there's always been people to deny the deity of Jesus and the relationship of the Father and Son. However, it makes it very clear here that this Antichrist, the Antichrist, when he comes, the person, the beast that you see in the Daniel and Book of Revelation is his system. It's his organization. But he is the little horn that rises up among the 10 horns there in the Book of Daniel, with the mouth speaking great things. When this man comes to power, the biggest thing he will say is Jesus is not the Son of God, which is, by the way, in the Quran and in the Hadith and all the teachings of Islam is very clear. They do not believe that God has a son. And that's the biggest problem when a Muslim comes to Christ that they have, of how do you take what we've been taught versus understanding the triunity of God, the manifestation of God. It's a struggle for them.
So let's take it in, because we're quickly running out of time, and we're going to continue next week in the same theme and the same thought. But let's take these things that we put out on the table today and try to bring them together, Perry, as we bring them to a close. And it's simply this. This spirit that denies the relationship between the Father and Son, that denies that Jesus was the Son of God, and Islam, that is part and parcel. This spirit, according to what Jesus said, in the last days is going to come and take you out of the synagogue and put you to death in the name of God. Yeah. Now, if that's not Islam, I don't know what is. This spirit, Perry, as we bring this to a close, how in the world then, as I ask you, we're on the same page, we believe the same thing. But if one of our critics was standing here right now, when we say, how in the world can you identify the spirit of Islam very clear as the spirit of Antichrist, and how do they come up with an Antichrist from some other system?
Well, the biggest argument you hear all the time is the Antichrist is a Jew from the tribe of Dan. First thing I learned in the Middle East is Muslims are never going to follow a Jew.
Yeah.
And as a matter of fact, I had five Jewish people tell me, they said, we think the reason that God allowed President Bush to be elected instead of Al Gore was Al Gore had, and these are Jewish people in Israel telling me this, is Al Gore had a Jewish vice president, and you'd have never been in a war in Afghanistan, and you would have never been in a war in Iraq, because the Muslims would have felt that the Jews were trying to take over the world. Now, that was, I'm not saying that is or not. I'm saying that was their concept
as to
why it went the way that it did.
Right.
But, you know, the thing is that when you talk about this, number one, the Muslims are never going to follow a Jewish leader. Number two, there's only 15 million Jews in the world. And if you make the Jew a Jew, the Antichrist, then why is he turning on the Jews, killing the Jews, chasing the Jews out, which Jewish people worldwide have to stick together? Now, that teaching came among the early church fathers for because of two or three verses that they interpreted, which was a self-interpretation, not the actual interpretation of the verse itself. And it came because there was a lot of anti-Semitic feelings between the rabbis who were just blasting Christ and blasting the virgin birth and the early fathers. And so the fathers just really came along and said, you know, he must be a Jew from the tribe of Dan. And those two verses that people use, we can cover down the road later in one of the passages to from the scripture to help explain that.
Yeah. Well, as I bring out in my book and you do in yours, and again, you must get this week's offer. Again, these are the two main books in this offer, but we have other materials as well. In fact, we're going to take this entire discussion of Perry and I for these four or five broadcasts and put onto one DV and make that a part of that. But as we're going to identify, the spirit of Antichrist is the spirit of Islam. And the Mahdi, Let's go there next week. I know you introduced it. Mm-hmm. The Mahdi is their personage. Mm-hmm. And the parallels between this end time personage in Islam fit and correlate so wonderfully. Now, some believe that he's coming from Europe because it is a revived European Union. We're going to show you in the coming weeks, because we're all out of time right now. Our announcer is going to come. Please don't miss next week. In fact, I would call someone and tell them, have you seen Joe and Perry on God's News? You've got to tune in and watch this. Here's our announcer one final time this week for our broadcast. Please avail yourself of these important ministry materials.
Will a coalition of Islamic nations soon form, creating the final kingdom for the Antichrist to emerge? Do Islamic predictions for the end time actually correlate in many ways to what the biblical prophecies declare? In Perry Stone's revised landmark new book, Unleashing the Beast, these questions and many more are answered for you. One chapter in this new book is so controversial that once printed, bookstores refuse to carry it. In addition, Unveiling the Man of Sin, written by Dr. Joe VanKoevering, has become the most talked about book in prophecy circles. In this must-read volume, Joe not only reveals exactly where the Antichrist will emerge from, but he shares the actual name of a man who can fulfill all of the biblical prophecies regarding the Antichrist. And lastly, Joe VanKoevering and Perry Stone have just finished this 90-minute DVD where they answer the many skeptics of how the Islamic world will in fact produce the coming man of sin, the Antichrist himself. Learn who the 12th Imam actually is. Discover why Babylon must rise to world prominence again, and so much more. With this one-of-a-kind new DVD, you can literally sit down with these two scholars and have your prophetic questions answered. All three of these items are now yours for a gift of only $45. Send your gift to God's News, Box 10475, St. Petersburg, Florida, 33733. Or call now, 888-GOD'S-NEWS. That's 888-463-7639. Make that call and start to understand the Islamic beast.
I'm so glad that you've joined us today for this very special broadcast of God's News. I'm in the studio with no stranger to our viewers, one of my best friends in all the world, Manifest and Evangelist Perry Stone. Welcome, Perry.
I'm just sitting here thinking, I like your shirt.
Do you?
I'm going to switch shirts with you later.
Really? Okay. He's already bartered me out of my shirt.
I wear the same old shirts all the time on our program, so I'm going to have to go shopping sometime, it looks like.
Well, I'll take you
with me.
I'll
go shopping with you. You look like you know where to go.
I guess I do. I buy everything at discount. I guarantee you. I promise you, I'll get you some good prices.
All right.
Perry, last week we introduced, for our viewers maybe that are tuning in just for the first time, your book, landmark book, Unleashing the Beast, that you wrote 5-6 years ago.
But I rewrote it.
You rewrote it now.
40% of it's new.
Unleashing the Beast, totally new, and we're going to make it available to our viewers. And it deals with the same thing my book, Unveiling the Man of Sin, deals with, and that is the subject. Some people say, well, the Antichrist has got to come from Europe. The Antichrist has got to come from Rome. Mm-hmm. After all, there's a verse in the book of Daniel that seems to indicate that he's got to come from Rome. And by the time we're through, I want to show many verses in the book of Daniel that make it clear he cannot and will not come from Rome. In fact, you have a number of chapters you deal with this in your book. I have a whole chapter entitled The Myth of the European Man of Sin. Mm-hmm. But let's get to it, because if people do not understand the image that God showed Daniel, dream that he gave to Nebuchadnezzar, and we have the image right here behind us, then they will forever misplace
the location
of where he comes from.
Yeah.
So Perry?
All right, let's begin, because you said something a moment ago. You know, Paul said in 2 Thessalonians 2, the Antichrist, the man of sin, is revealed in his time.
Yep.
And I think over the years people have tried to identify him with dictators. They've tried to identify him by adding up people's names to 666. But if we go simply back to the scripture, it's very clear, if we stick to the basic interpretation of scripture, where this man comes from. Now, King Nebuchadnezzar had a dream of a metallic image, and we're going to show you a model of that image right now. We're going to go down it from the top to the bottom, and we're going to explain to you the interpretation in Daniel and in history as to who these kingdoms are. And it's very important that we tie this in later with the book of Revelation, okay?
Very important.
And we're going to put it together. So let's look at the image right now. This image had a head that was made of gold, which according to Daniel, the prophecy in history itself, is the Babylonian Empire. The Babylonians were then overtaken by the kingdom of silver arms. And notice there's two arms, and that represents the Media Empire and the Persian Empire that joined together as one. In fact, Finnis Dake talks about 10 major kings of those empires, and you happen to have 10 fingers on your hands, which is interesting. Following the Media-Persian Empire, it was overtaken by Alexander the Great, the Grecian Empire, which is identified then in this vision as the thighs of brass. And one of the reasons is the armies of Alexandria used a lot of brass weaponry. Following Alexander the Great's kingdom, the Roman Empire began to form. It's identified in this dream of Nebuchadnezzar as two legs of iron. And of course, we know that in the time of Constantine, Rome was one form. It was called the Western Leg. And the Eastern Leg was a city that Constantine built called Constantinople, located in Turkey. And what's interesting is that from 800 to 1806, the Roman Church, the Holy Roman Empire, the Roman Church, ruled from the western side of that leg. And from the 4th century to the 1400s, the Byzantine Empire, Byzantine Christians, ruled on the eastern side of that leg. So that's history. When you get to the end of the image, you have two feet, and they are a mixture of iron and clay, and there also are 10 toes. Now, you will read in a moment about 10 kings, and the 10 kings in the book of Revelation are the same as these 10 toes on this image, which are also identified as 10 kings.
Yes.
Now, Joe, what I want to do now is read Daniel chapter 7.
Okay.
And then I'm going to go to an image which is behind me, and this again is made out of styrofoam to help people get the mental image of what the men saw. In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head while on his bed. Then he wrote down the dream, telling the main facts. Daniel spoke, saying, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, four winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea. Now that, by the way, is the Mediterranean Sea. Any commentary will tell you that. It was called the Great Sea in Daniel's day. Four great beasts came up from the sea, each one different from the other. The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. I watched till the wings were plucked off, and it was lifted up from the earth and made to stand on 2 feet like a man, and a man's heart was given it. Suddenly another beast, a second like a bear, it was raised up on one side and had three ribs in its mouth between its teeth, and they said thus to it, arise, devour much flesh. I looked, and there was another like a leopard which had on its back four wings of a bird. That beast also had four heads, and dominion was given over. And of course he sees this fourth beast, which he does not identify here. But watch this.
Yeah.
John does identify this beast beginning in verse 7 in Revelation 13. Now let me go to not only the historical interpretation, the biblical interpretation, the primary interpretation, and the early church fathers' interpretation of this passage. Very simple. The lion is Babylon. The bear is Media Persia. The leopard is the Grecian Empire. The four wings are the four generals who took over Alexander the Great's Grecian Empire when Alexander the Great died.
Which is critical, and maybe next week I want to deal with that there, the four generals.
Yeah, the four generals. Now, here's the part that you've got to grasp this.
Yes.
600 and some years later, in the book of Revelation, John sees a vision on the Isle of Patmos. Now, watch how he describes the Antichrist. He says, I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having seven heads and 10 horns and 10 on his horns, 10 crowns, and on his head, a blasphemous name. Now, the beast that I saw was like a leopard, his feet like the feet of a bear, his mouth like the mouth of a lion. Now, those are the same three imageries that we see where? In the book of Daniel.
Right.
Now, I want him to go behind me and show you an image of this, and this is, again, an artist's rendering of this. This beast that John saw in the book of Revelation. Now, remember, he's got seven heads, but he's got 10 horns. Now, Joe, if you'll notice that, and I want the people at home to notice, that you can only fit so many horns on seven heads. And if you've got seven heads, you've got a couple horns that are double
extra horns.
On there. Yeah, you've
That's
got
right.
extra horns, okay?
What are you going to do with those?
Yeah, what are you going to do with those? All right, now, just a point to bring out. But let's go back. I want you to just stay on the image, guys. The image has the body of a leopard. All right, now, the leopard is Alexander the Great, but that identifies the swiftness. Now, you also read where the mouth of this beast is like a lion. So we see the lion's mouth. Now, a lion, by the way, will devour and is known as a carnivore. It's a but it's also the king of the beasts, right? Notice now the feet, and you can see if you go down a little bit further on the picture here, the feet are like the feet of a bear. Now, a bear's claws are the most dangerous part of it. right? You get with a bear, you know, its claws can just shred you. So the leopard is the speed of this kingdom. The mouth of the lion, the Bible says the Antichrist has a mouth speaking great things, but the Bible describes those claws as tearing and devouring, okay, tearing and devouring. Now, go back to the image one more time, guys, behind me, and let me explain something to you that is the key central point of this. Number one, everything on the image of Nebuchadnezzar, the image of his dream, is Gentile. But watch this. Where did the Lion Kingdom rule? From the country of Iraq and Syria, Lebanon, old Babylonian territory.
You mean it wasn't Rome?
No, it wasn't Rome. Where did the leopard rule? The leopard ruled northern Africa, Greece, all the way toward India, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iraq, Iran, Lebanon, Syria.
Uh-oh,
here we go. Where did the bear rule? That was the Persian Empire. It ruled Persia, Afghanistan, Pakistan.
Persia, by the way, is Iran.
It's Iran today.
Okay, Persia
right.
is Iran.
Persia is Iran today. Yeah. And it ruled Iraq, Syria, yep. Lebanon. And, of course, it also had a control in the northern part of Africa. But the point is that this imagery of this beast that John saw in Revelation chapter 13 has two things in common. Number one, the Antichrist is a combination of all three previous empires of prophecy mentioned in the book of Daniel. Mm-hmm. He combines the Babylonian territory, he combines the Medo-Persian territory, and the ancient Grecian territory, watch carefully, into one system under his caliph or under his control. And here's what he does. Daniel 11, he takes over Egypt, Libya, and Ethiopia. All three Islamic countries.
Today. countries.
That's right. Now, they have Christians in them, but they're predominantly Muslims.
Absolutely.
There's Christians in Egypt and in Ethiopia, but predominantly Muslim. Now, watch this. The Bible says he's great to the east.
That's so important.
That's the territory of Jordan, Iraq, Iran. Now, this beast behind me, he ruled from Pakistan and Afghanistan. All right? Now, we're using the names of the countries today to help you to understand
that's
where it's
it.
At.
Yep.
Then the Grecian Empire moved all the way toward India, all the way into the northern part of Africa, and up to the north of Israel, which would be Macedonia, Greece, and Turkey today. Now, here's the bottom line. There is no way I can go to that beast or go to Daniel chapter 2 or go to any of the imagery and get France, England, Ireland, Scotland,
Luxembourg, all these
Belgium.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? Now,
that's right.
While some of those, yes, were in the old Roman Empire territory, listen, look at the countries that were in the Roman Empire territory that are not presently in the EU, which is what everybody's teaching, that the Antichrist rules over.
That's it.
Now, see, let me tell you where they miss it, Joe, in my opinion, and we can get into this.
We've got 30 seconds.
Okay. They miss it in understanding that John in Revelation said there's a seventh empire that continues for a short space. That's a global government. That involves the North American Union, plus it involves the EU and all these other countries forming a global government. But the Antichrist seizes that and forms the eighth kingdom for 42 months. There's what they're missing. This beast is the eighth kingdom of prophecy. They're trying to make it the seventh. It doesn't work.
What he just said in just a few minutes is all in this landmark new book. Here's our announcer to tell you how you can have this in your own home.
Will a coalition of Islamic nations soon form, creating the final kingdom for the Antichrist to emerge? Do Islamic predictions for the end time actually correlate in many ways to what the biblical prophecies declare? In Perry Stone's revised landmark new book, Unleashing the Beast, these questions and many more are answered for you. One chapter in this new book is so controversial that once printed, bookstores refuse to carry it. In addition, Unveiling the Man of Sin, written by Dr. Joe VanKoevering, has become the most talked about book in prophecy circles. In this must-read volume, Joe not only reveals exactly where the Antichrist will emerge from, but he shares the actual name of a man who can fulfill all of the biblical prophecies regarding the Antichrist. And lastly, Joe VanKoevering and Perry Stone have just finished this 90-minute DVD where they answer the many skeptics of how the Islamic world will in fact produce the coming man of sin, the Antichrist himself. Learn who the 12th Imam actually is. Discover why Babylon must rise to world prophecy. prominence again, and so much more. With this one-of-a-kind new DVD, you can literally sit down with these two scholars and have your prophetic questions answered. All three of these items are now yours for a gift of only $45. Send your gift to God's News, Box 10475, St. Petersburg, Florida, 33733. Or call now, 888-GOD'S-NEWS. That's 888-463-7639. Make that call and start to understand the Islamic beast.
Oh my goodness, we are overwhelmed, Perry and I, at the moment right now. I mean, the things that he just told you, to grasp all of it. I mean, we're basically, Perry, just scratching the surface, doing as good as we can. You've just got to get this book. You must make this call. I want to put this book, along with my book, Unveiling the Man of Sin, and the DVD of all of this teaching, plus a special prophetic update from him on the 44th President of the United States and how that might fit in as well. Perry, as we take this final segment of our broadcast today, try to capsulize some of the things you said. And I want to give a quote. I want my producer to put this quote up on the screen, because this is what you say right in the book. Mm-hmm. And then have you comment on it. From page 19, according to Daniel and John, two apocalyptic prophets whose biblical predictions have fascinated, inspired, and yes, at times bewildered generations of Christians, a final empire will form that will control all buying and selling and will behead those who resist. And we've got to deal with beheading even more than we did last week. Then you say this, I believe this final prophetic empire is an Islamic coalition of nations, that's the key phrase, whose influence will overshadow the Middle East and much of Europe, and whose heart will beat the strongest in the regions of Syria, Iraq, and Iran. We need to explain why you believe that. Its command center will be in Iraq and will be eventually moved to Jerusalem, and the man who will direct this final showdown among the nations will be the Antichrist of biblical prophecy.
Right.
Comment on that.
Okay, let's begin. There's a lot of ways we can go right here, but let's go back to this is the area in the Bible, in the book of Daniel chapter 11, and also when you look at the imagery of this beast that we just showed a moment ago from Revelation 13, here's the area of the Antichrist domain. Here it is, Egypt, Libya, and Ethiopia. That's in Daniel 11. The Antichrist overthrows these three nations. Now, here's what's interesting. The early fathers said that there would be 10 kings, and these were three of the 10 that the Antichrist would overthrow.
But now, wait a minute, Perry. I've heard prophecy scholar so-and-so and watched his television broadcast, and he said that it was going to be Europe, and those 13 nations finally came in the EU, and those three nations were Spain and a couple of others.
Right.
Now you're saying that the Bible identifies the three that come out?
I've got to stick with the Bible instead of the prophecy preacher on this one.
We're going to stick with the Bible.
Yeah, here's the thing, though. When the common market, as it was known previously, had 10 kingdoms, everybody thought the last days were here. Then they got 12. Then they got 15. How many they got now, Joe?
There's over 30. How in the world you can take a 10-toed, 10-kinged beast image system that Daniel describes, and we just went through Revelation describes, and fit a 35, and it's growing all the time, EU into it.
Let me explain what Daniel saw. He said he saw a little horn rising among these 10 kings, and he uproots three of the 10. Now, obviously, in Daniel 11, he names the three.
There
Egypt, Libya, and Ethiopia
there
will be at his steps. That's an Antichrist verse. And that's why the early fathers. Now, this brings a new twist on it. Is the EU a part of the 10 kings? Answer, no.
No.
No. EU will be under the influence. All of Europe is going to come under the dominion and influence of this man because of the buying and the selling, the judgments which have struck the earth, food shortages and things of this nature. He will control the food. And let me stop. I got to say this. One of the reasons that the Antichrist moves, in fact, let me just read this to you. Out of one of them comes a little horn which grows exceedingly great to the south. Now, the south is Egypt, Libya, and Ethiopia.
And the reference there is Daniel 8.
Daniel 8, 9.
Okay.
Toward the east. The east would be from Jordan,
that's
Iraq, Iran,
toward
Pakistan, Afghanistan.
Toward the east.
And the glorious land, which everyone knows, is Israel.
That's Israel.
Okay, I got to ask you a question. Why does the Antichrist want Israel? Stop and just think for a moment. And you've been there with me, and I can tell you why he wants Israel. It's called food. Okay. In the tribulation period, there are massive food shortages until they're rationing bread. They're rationing wheat, I'm sorry, and barley, and it costs you a day's wages just to get enough barley to feed one person or enough wheat to feed one person. And Israel is one of those countries that has underground aquifers in the Arava and in the Jordan Rift Valley, and they have a drip irrigation system, and they literally can have some places two harvest times a year, and they have enough food being produced to feed all their nation, and they can ship. The last number I got was about 400 to 500% or more outside of the country to sell it to other countries. So when the surrounding nations, you know, the Euphrates River in the tribulation dries up, Joe, well, that's the water source to water the whole Fertile Crescent from Syria, parts of, you know, Syria and Iraq. You got to have the Euphrates River.
And your point here, I believe, is
they want
is that water and food.
That's where the war's going to be over.
Is going to be what the conflict is over.
I know a military person who told me the next big war in the future, we're talking not skirmish, not a war with Israel, the next big war is food and water. There is no doubt. And so he's going to go where he can feed his people. And the reason he develops a buying and selling, is if you look and read we've done this before, Joe and I have done this, read the verse of 666, no man can buy and sell without the mark, the name of the number, is he wants you to join his religion and his religious cause, and he will guarantee you the food that he has taken control of in the one area where you can still get food. If you don't become a part of his religious system, because it's the false prophet that issues the mark, read it. We call it the mark of the beast, and that's what it is. But he's working for the Antichrist, with the Antichrist. So food is going to be a big, big, big part of this. Now,
get back to when it says he's great to the east.
Okay.
Because that's very important. Yeah. Because if you look at a calendar, not a calendar, but a map, and you see where Israel is, because everything, when it describes to the north or to the south or the east, it's the focal point is Israel,
always
as you know.
Israel.
It's always Israel, biblically. So it's like to the north of Israel or to the south of Israel or to the east or west of Israel. So when it says he's great to the east, Perry, where is Rome? Is Rome to the east of Israel?
No, it's actually north.
It's to the northwest.
Northwest, yeah.
So when it says he's great to the east, Perry,
well, here's the key.
How many nations are to the east of Israel, and are they all Islamic? Are they all not? That's exactly the region that we're trying to define.
Can I show you this
yes.
here? This is a key. This is a clue. In chapter 8,
yes.
Daniel sees a ram and a goat. The ram. Let me just read it. I was considering a male goat came from the west across the surface of the whole earth without touching the ground, and the goat had a notable horn between his eyes. This is Alexander the Great.
The Grecian
he came to the ram
Empire.
that had two horns, Median Persia,
mm-hmm.
which I had seen standing beside the river, and ran at him with furious power. Now, they had a battle at a river. This literally happened in history.
Yeah.
And Alexander the Great defeated the Medes and Persians. I saw him confronting the ram. He was moved with rage against him, attacked the ram, and broke his two horns. So the Medo-Persian Empire was broken by Alexander the Great.
Mm-hmm.
There was no power in the ram to withstand him, but he cast him down to the ground, trampled him. There was no one that could deliver him. Now watch this.
This is important.
Therefore, the male
goat
grew very great. When he became strong, the large horn was broken. Alexander the Great, at age 33, conquered the known world and died in Babylon.
In Babylon.
Probably either drunk or an overdose
Whatever.
Or something. Okay, we're not sure.
Four notable ones.
I forgot that verse. Yeah. Read that.
Four notable ones toward the four winds of heaven.
Came up, yeah.
Yeah. So in other words, his empire, we've only have a few minutes, Barry.
His empire divided
four areas.
Four areas. Okay,
And then it
about
says
those
this in,
a in
verse 9.
Out of one of them came a little horn which grew exceedingly great to the south, that's the northern part of Egypt, toward the east, which is Jordan, Iraq, Iran, Pakistan, Afghanistan, toward the glorious land, which is Israel. And it grew up to the host of heaven and cast him down to the ground. And here's the
that
point.
That is the Antichrist.
That's the
little horn.
That's right. Now,
yep.
Here, Alexander the King, I'm going to abbreviate this, make it short. Alexander the Great's kingdom was divided between northern Africa with one general, Turkey with another general, Greece and Macedonia with another general, and Syria and Iraq and Lebanon with another general.
Hello.
Okay? He takes over Africa.
Yep.
He's not from there, but he takes it over. So that
eliminates
that
one.
The king of the north pushes at him in the tribulation, which is Turkey. That eliminates them.
That eliminates the world of the north.
That leaves two areas.
There's only two left.
Greece and Macedonia. Or, yep. Guess what?
Or
the place the Mahdi is supposed to come from. The country
Iraq,
of Iraq.
Exactly.
Hello.
Yep.
That brings you to
ancient Babylon.
Ancient Babylon's territory.
Is the region. I want to make this. I know we've lost some people. And listen, it's all documented. Perry's got a whole chapter in his book. I got a whole chapter on the European myth of the man of sin. And I document these four generals and show you that according to the book of Daniel, Daniel identifies where he comes up. And lo and behold, it's the same place. You know, you have a chapter on the new Babylon and rebuilding of Babylon.
Yeah.
Maybe we need to come back next week and talk about that, because one of the titles the Antichrist is given in Isaiah 14, as you know, is the King of Babylon.
Yeah.
So why, folks, are we looking to Europe? Why, folks, are we looking to an EU that's now got over 30 nations when Daniel makes it very clear and John makes it very clear? It's 10 toes. It's 10 kings.
Hey, Joe, why does Revelation 17:18 say Mystery Babylon?
Yeah.
I mean, the name Babylon is right there in the book of Revelation.
But you know and I know, great scholars make that Rome.
Yeah.
Like somehow God's a schizophrenic. At the end of time, for 6,000 years of history, Babylon has always been at the land of Shinar and the Euphrates River.
Right.
And suddenly, at the very end of time, God moves Babylon to New York or moves Babylon to Rome. I don't buy it. I don't believe it.
Well, it's not true. I can tell you this. He definitely does not come out of the United States. The United States is going to be connected, I believe, to forming a global government with Europe and with the rest of them for the Seventh Empire. We got to go back. Let's talk about that Seventh Empire on the next time we get together. That explains the controversy.
Yeah.
That clears it up.
Absolutely. Listen, we're not trying to confuse you. We're trying to bless you, trying to answer the questions. And really, you've got to get the materials, and that's why we put this package together so you can watch it over and over again. You can read the words chapter after chapter. The bottom line is if we're this close to the coming of the Antichrist, then how close are we to the return of the Lord Jesus Christ?
Oh, yes.
If you do not know Him as Savior and Lord, will you pray this prayer right now? I'm here to tell you that Jesus will come into your life.
God.
He will set you free. He will cleanse you from sin. If you would just call on His name, Lord Jesus, I call on your name now. Will you come into my life? Save me. Cleanse me. I believe you're the Son of God who died for me and shed your blood to forgive me of my sin. Jesus, come into my heart. I trust you now as Savior and Lord. If you prayed that prayer, I want to hear from you this week. I'm all out of time. Here's our announcer one final time. Will you stand with me? Will you stand with this prophetic ministry? I want to put these materials into your hands. One last time this week. Here's our announcer.
Will a coalition of Islamic nations soon form, creating the final kingdom for the Antichrist to emerge? Do Islamic predictions for the end time actually correlate in many ways to what the biblical prophecies declare? In Perry Stone's revised landmark new book, Unleashing the Beast, these questions and many more are answered for you. One chapter in this new book is so controversial that once printed, bookstores refuse to carry it. In addition, Unveiling the Man of Sin, written by Dr. Joe VanKoevering, has become the most talked about book in prophecy circles. In this must-read volume, Joe not only reveals exactly where the Antichrist will emerge from, but he shares the actual name of a man who can fulfill all of the biblical prophecies regarding the Antichrist. And lastly, Joe VanKoevering and Perry Stone have just finished this 90-minute DVD where they answer the many skeptics of how the Islamic world will in fact produce the coming man of sin, the Antichrist himself. Learn who the 12th Imam actually is. Discover why Babylon must rise to world prominence again, and so much more. With this one-of-a-kind new DVD, you can literally sit down with these two scholars and have your prophetic questions answered. All three of these items are now yours for a gift of only $45. Send your gift to God's News, Box 10475, St. Petersburg, Florida, 33733. Or call now, 888-GOD'S-NEWS. That's 888-463-7639. Make that call and start to understand the Islamic beast.
Oh, praise God. Welcome. This is Joe VanKoevering, and you are watching God's News Behind the News. I'm thrilled wherever you're tuning in today from around the world. This is a Bible prophecy broadcast. You've tuned in at the right time because I have one of my favorite buddies, scholars of Bible prophecy. We've done so many shows together, and we're really sharing some things, yes. I believe, Perry, in these broadcasts that simply, I don't know any other broadcast that talks about these things.
Right. Well, Joe and I agree on about everything except football teams.
I was about
but
to say.
We're not going to go into that.
I know. It's college football season.
Although my team last year was undefeated. Okay. We won't talk about that.
Well, if Alabama ever plays Florida State again, I'm sure the good guys in Garnet and Gold will win.
I love it. I love that. I love Joe. I love football season with Joe. I really do.
And it's finally here.
Yeah.
Now, Perry, last week, I think we lost maybe a few people.
Well, you're thinking, I don't think we did, but well, we may have.
We really, you know, we kind of went fast there at the very
Send
end.
Send your emails in. Did we lose you or not? We'll find out and take a poll. No, it can get complicated when you're going fast. We want to slow down, and you've got a point that you really want to make. I want you to just go with it. You need
to. Well, here's what I believe, Perry. I believe that most viewers and lovers of Bible prophecy have heard from this prophecy preacher and mm-hmm. that prophecy preacher and this well-known TV mm-hmm. prophecy expert. They've heard Rome and the EU week after week after week after week, mm-hmm. and to where they're convinced now that when we come along and say, no, stop looking at Rome, look mm-hmm. somewhere else, that it takes a while for them to digest that. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to go again to the critical passage in Daniel 8. You have an entire chapter in your book devoted to this. I have an entire chapter mm-hmm. in my book devoted to this subject as well, the myth of the European Antichrist, and here's one of the main texts. The four generals mm-hmm. that came up after Alexander the Great's empire came to the end. Alexander died, as you said, as a young man in right. Babylon is where he right. died. They took the kingdom and divided it into four parts.
Right.
It's critical that they understand that. Here's the reason why. Because Daniel says in Daniel 8:9, out of one of them, one of those four regions came forth the little horn, who waxed exceeding great toward the south, toward the east, and toward the pleasant land. That is so important. Again, it's Daniel 8:9. Now, who were those four generals and what were those four regions? Because you list them and I do too.
Right.
There was Ptolemy.
Right.
And he was over the area of what we know today as the Egypt area.
Northern Africa.
Okay, Northern Africa and Egypt, which is south of the Promised Land, Israel.
Right.
Then there was Seleucus, and he was the ruler over the area of Turkey. Is that right? No, he was over
Syria.
Syria and Iraq.
Right.
That very, very important.
That territory.
That's the important
that's
one.
That's where Antiochus Epiphanes, who is a picture of the Antichrist, came from, the Seleucid dynasty.
Okay.
And that is Syria and Iraq today.
And right. then, and all this can be proven historically. These four generals' names are given to us. Lysimachus, which was the Turkish area or the southern Russia, and then Cassander, which is the Grecian and Macedonian area.
Right.
So there's four: Egypt, Turkey, Greece and Macedonia, and then the all-important Syria and Iraq.
Right, right.
So when we say it's got to be Syria and Iraq, again, why do we say that?
We say that, first of all, let's go back to the imagery. And they're not really prepared to do this, but I want them to show this beast, which we showed on a previous program.
Okay.
This is a real key, because in the book of Daniel, Daniel sees one beast like a lion, one beast like a bear, one beast like a leopard, and the interpretation is Babylon, Media, Persia, and the Grecian Empire. This is the imagery of Revelation chapter 13, where there's one beast, and he has the paws of a bear, he has the body of a leopard, and the mouth of a lion. These three places are in the ancient Babylonian territory of Afghanistan, Pakistan, Iran, Iraq, Lebanon, and Syria. This beast is going to be an Islamic empire which combines the three first empires of Bible prophecy into one unit. And that is what I remember having lunch with an Israeli Knesset member. And several years ago, and I said, what is one of your greatest concerns? And they said, one of our greatest concerns is that there will come one man who could somehow merge Iraq, Iran, Syria, Lebanon under one control and reform the Babylonian Empire. Because that would be one of the greatest threats, he said, to the existence of Israel, is to have at your back door multiple hundreds of millions of people who wanted the destruction of the Jewish state. And really, that's the reason we keep telling people it is not about Europe. And I want to make this clear. And Joe, you may want to go somewhere, but I want to go in a moment. Let me just explain this. This will explain to people that there's...
Please.
And I want you to hear this. There's actually two more empires coming. Remember, you have the feet and the ten toes.
And the toes.
Feet and toes. You've had the two legs of iron and clay, and you can divide that up into communism and democracy. You can divide it up between the Byzantine and the Holy Roman Empire. You can do all sorts of things. But 2 feet, ten toes. Now, I'm going to read Revelation chapter 17 and verse 9. Here is mine that has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits. There are also seven kings. Five are fallen. Now, the five that are fallen, and this is a primary historic interpretation, Egypt, Assyria, Syria, Babylon, Media-Persia, and Greece.
And Greece.
They were fallen in John's
Nobody
day, 95 AD. You can't argue that, right.
But then
now,
the one that is,
one is
that's the Roman
present
Empire.
Tense in Greek, that was the Roman Empire. The other has not yet come, and when he comes, he must continue a short time. Now, that's a verse that nobody reads, pays attention to. That's the key. Watch. The beast that was and is not himself is also the eighth, and is of the seven, means one of the seven previous empires. He is out of one of the seven empires of prophecy and is going into perdition. Now, what is interesting here is there is a sixth empire ruling in John's day, which was the Roman Empire. That Roman Empire branched between the East and West throughout history. There is, however, a seven-year tribulation in which, Joe, a seventh empire rules the first 42 months. Then an eighth empire rules the last 42 months. I preached prophecy for years and never saw this before. Now, when people talk about globalism, the EU, America going into a global government, that is the seventh empire of prophecy that lasts a short space, which is ruling the first 42 months of the tribulation. The Antichrist then, because the Bible says he comes up among the ten kings. These ten kingdoms and kings are already there. And in Revelation, it says in 1 hour, he gives those ten kings power. The beast gives them power in 1 hour, meaning they exist and they capitulate and submit their kingdom to the Antichrist, eighth kingdom.
Yeah.
So in other words, the confusion is coming in. Now listen carefully. When prophetic ministers try to make the EU the final kingdom.
Right.
That's
it.
The problem.
Say that.
Now listen again. When they try to make the EU the last and final kingdom and the Antichrist is ruling, they're not realizing or dividing a seventh and an eighth.
Right, right.
The seventh one is being formed with globalism.
That's good.
Okay, Joe, something's got to rule the first 42 months because the Antichrist invades Jerusalem in the middle, and Daniel says he rules for time, times, and dividing a time. Time is 1 year, times is two, half a time is six months, 42 months. And the Bible says the Gentiles, not the Jews, the Gentiles will trample the holy city for 1,260 days, which is Jerusalem, or 42 months.
Right.
So if we can understand, this is a real key verse. This is one that's not hardly ever taught.
No.
If we can understand, there is a seventh empire, which is a continuation of the territory of ancient Rome. However, it is connected globally too.
Right.
Okay. Then Antichrist invades Jerusalem, takes those ten kings, starts a war. Who can make war against the beast? Mm-hmm. Then he forms the eighth, and it rules for 42 months. Now, is the tribulation 7 years? Sure. Daniel 9:27. It's a seven-year period. And it's divided in Revelation into two halves. But the time that he rules is eighth. He is the eighth for 42 months. And that's the one, could preach right here, that you see the ten kings, and it says, I saw a stone hewn out of a mountain that came down and crushed that image of Nebuchadnezzar in his dream in Daniel 2, and all those kingdoms were crushed together when the Messiah returned. Yeah. So those ten kings, in fact, it says in the days of those ten kings, that's when the Lord returns.
Right.
So that's what we're looking for now is who are the ten? Can we identify them? Have they formed yet or not? And that's really where people should be kind of a little bit interested in if they keep up with prophetic things.
Now, Perry, you teach and believe that's got to be Babylon, right?
Yeah.
And I know some scholars read Revelation where it talks about mystery Babylon, and they want to, again, and I ranted a little time last week, they want to make this Rome.
Well, I can go back to this verse, Joe, and prove
well,
it. You want to do that?
Can we, because we've only got about a minute here before we take a break, okay. But you have mm-hmm. in here Babylon back from the dead.
Right.
Okay? And if I could give this verse, this is very important.
Yeah.
And then we're gonna go to our announcer, all right, Perry? But in Isaiah 14, a key text, it talks about Lucifer, the son of the morning. And you need to get my book that we're offering, and I'll explain to you how that ties with Islam, by the way. But he was cut down to the ground. And, of course, the five I wills, where he said, I will ascend to heaven, I will exalt mm-hmm. my throne, I will sit in the sides of the north, and I will ascend, and I will be like the Most High God. Then it says this, yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit, and they that look shall narrowly look upon thee, and consider, saying, here it is this the man that made the earth to tremble and that did shake kingdoms? Now, we know he's describing Lucifer. We know he's describing this angelic being that fell from the presence of God, that literally became who we call and know as the devil or Satan, but yet he calls him a man. And the man's identity, if you go back to verse 4, uh-huh. it says he says this, take up this proverb against the king of Babylon. And here's the point. This is a clear identification of the man of sin, the Antichrist, who we're trying to identify yeah. and where he comes from. He's the king of Babylon. And again, I'll say it, Babylon has only been in one place in the Bible and only remains in one place in the Bible. Here's our announcer. I'm going to come back, and Perry,
I'm going to prove the Babylon from Revelation must be rebuilt. From the Word.
I'll be right back. Here's our announcer to give you details of this offer.
Will a coalition of Islamic nations soon form, creating the final kingdom for the Antichrist to emerge? Do Islamic predictions for the end time actually correlate in many ways to what the biblical prophecies declare? In Perry Stone's revised landmark new book, Unleashing the Beast, these questions and many more are answered for you. One chapter in this new book is so controversial that once printed, bookstores refuse to carry it. In addition, Unveiling the Man of Sin, written by Dr. Joe VanKoevering, has become the most talked about book in prophecy circles. In this must-read volume, Joe not only reveals exactly where the Antichrist will emerge from, but he shares the actual name of a man who can fulfill all of the biblical prophecies regarding the Antichrist. And lastly, Joe VanKoevering and Perry Stone have just finished this 90-minute DVD where they answer the many skeptics of how the Islamic world will in fact produce the coming man of sin, the Antichrist himself. Learn who the 12th Imam actually is. Discover why Babylon must rise to world prominence again, and so much more. With this one-of-a-kind new DVD, you can literally sit down with these two scholars and have your prophetic questions answered. All three of these items are now yours for a gift of only $45. Send your gift to God's News, Box 10475, St. Petersburg, Florida, 33733. Or call now, 888-GOD'S-NEWS. That's 888-463-7639. Make that call and start to understand the Islamic beast.
Thank you for making that call. Thank you for standing with us. We want to put this book and the other materials into your hands. I know it's going to bless you and answer all the questions that we're not able to answer in the brief time that we have on the air. Now, Perry, in your book, Chapter 8, you say Iraq, the future headquarters of the coming Antichrist. I just said that the Antichrist is identified in this place as the king of Babylon. Why do we believe Babylon must reemerge, and why do we believe that will be the headquarters of the coming Antichrist?
Well, first we have to identify that what is today the country of Iraq was the headquarters in the center of Babylon. That's point one. Babylon and Iraq. In fact, when Saddam Hussein used to send letters to the Israelis, he said King of Babylon. He signed him the King of Babylon.
Because he aspired to be that. Yeah.
Because he tried to imitate King Nebuchadnezzar. The second thing you got to remember is those first three empires of prophecy, the lion, the bear, and the leopard, the headquarters was in Babylon.
All in Babylon.
All three. The only one not in Babylon was Rome, mm-hmm. and it was out of Italy, the fourth empire. Now, again, that fourth beast is a bear, a leopard, and a lion, and that is, again, the territory of, this. Let's just say the heart of it is ancient Babylon, the country of Iraq. But really, Revelation 17 gives you the clue. Let me go back and read this again real careful, okay? And he sees a woman a woman riding a beast with seven heads and 10 horns. Okay, this is the antichrist system. But watch what he says. Here's mine that has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits. Now, if we take these, some people interpret these mountains as seven kingdoms, but Rome was built on seven hills, and Istanbul or Constantinople, Turkey, was also built on seven hills. Excuse me.
Now, why is Constantinople important? Because that was the eastern leg of the Roman Empire.
Yeah, in other words, in the image of Daniel chapter 2 of Nebuchadnezzar's dream,
two legs.
One is east, one is west.
And today people don't even understand that the original Roman Empire was still east and west.
From the 3rd century on, it was always divided and always has been.
Which was Constantinople.
Religiously, politically, economically. Now, there are seven kings, five are fallen. Now, we talked about that. Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Media, Persia, and Greece. Fallen. Now, watch this very carefully at home. One is, that is Rome, and the other is not yet come. When he comes, he continues a short space. That's the seventh empire. Watch this. The beast that was and is not is himself the eighth, meaning the eighth empire. He is of the seven. Wait a minute. He didn't name seven. He only named six.
Right.
Five are fallen, one is.
Right.
That's six. So he mentions the number seven here. It didn't say he was of the seventh empire. He said he's of one of the seven. Now watch the wording. Let's talk about the seven. Here's the seven empires. Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Media Persia, Greece, Rome, and watch this, the number seventh, which hadn't formed, which is the new global empire, which is headquartered out of Europe.
Okay.
So the EU is in there, but it's number seven. It's not the end of the Antichrist empire.
Okay.
Now here's what prophecy preachers do. When the Antichrist comes, he is of that seventh empire, which is the global government, which is forming, which
I
is the EU.
I see where you're going now. Right.
Doesn't say he's of the seventh empire. He's one of the seven.
Right.
That has existed in the past. One of those seven empires, he's of that. Now watch this. He says the beast that was, stop right there. His empire did exist. It is not. His empire didn't exist in John's day. But it will come back. That is the eighth empire of Bible prophecy. So here's the bottom line. I wanted to read the verse, then I'm going to give you a very simple explanation. Basically, what John is saying is that out of the previous empires of Bible prophecy, there is one that did not exist in his day at all, and that's the one that's coming back. Let's go over them. Egypt has always existed as Egypt, even though it's not an empire, okay? Assyria is Assyria. It has existed to this day, all through history, although
it's
not an empire.
Right.
Media Persia is the Persians, the Iranians call themselves Persians. They have always existed from the time they were an empire to today, although they are no longer an empire, they are a country. Greece, look at this. Greece still exists as the country of Greece. Let me just say it this way. What is the one empire in Bible prophecy that is the main empire in Daniel's day up to John's day? The main area of the world that is dead.
That disappeared.
It disappeared. You don't hear about it. You don't hear it by name.
But now it's suddenly
now
coming
it's reforming.
Back.
It's not Egypt. It's not Assyria.
Yep.
It's not Media Persia. It's
Isn't
not Greece. And it's not even Rome. Rome has always been there through either Constantinople, Turkey, which is the eastern branch, or Rome, which is the western branch. It did not exist.
Right.
But the beast has to be one of the seven, but it has to be one that did exist before John.
Yeah.
Was not existent in the time of John. Wait a minute, that eliminates the Roman Empire.
Yeah.
Because John says,
oh, he's excited now.
Wait. We just eliminated Rome.
They have to.
Because John says he was living in Rome.
Yeah.
He said, this one does not exist. John is telling you it's not the Roman Empire.
Right.
He's coming where? From Babylon. The
it's
only
got
one
to
that's
be.
Dead.
Right.
It's got to, I'm waxing warm right now.
He's fired
getting
up,
hot
folks.
In this
he's fired
okay,
up. I love it when he gets
Did everybody get what I just said, though?
I hope so.
John is writing in the time of the Roman Empire, and he says the beast is not.
Yeah.
If we're preaching it's all Roman Empire, we're going against what John said here.
Yeah,
because John is telling you the beast that's coming, it was, is not, but will come in the future and will ascend from the abyss.
Yep.
And so the demonic powers that will control the Antichrist the last 42 months give him his seat, his power, and his authority. But look, you know what? It's so simple because go and read what is John talking about right in chapter 17. Something called the Mystery Babylon.
There's the great.
Not Mystery Egypt, not Mystery Rome, not Mystery whatever. Now, scholars point out that Babylon at times was cryptically used by the Jews to identify the Roman Empire so they would not get in trouble. Okay,
yeah.
I agree with that. But I'm saying that when we, let me just say it this way. Yes, the EU is an empire that's forming, but it's seven. It's not the final. That's where I think most teachers get in trouble.
Yeah.
They make it the final.
You're right, Perry.
That the Antichrist rises out of that last seventh empire. There is an eight. Now look, John, oh my, Daniel did not see this eight, but he did see it. Here's how he saw it. He saw 10 kings. There's your seventh empire, but he saw a little horn rising among them.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So in other words, when he saw the little horn, he did see the eighth kingdom. He didn't identify it. John identified it later, because you've got to study this by putting Daniel and the book of Revelation together, and the imagery that both of these men saw is the same. The ten toes are ten kings. The ten horns are ten kings. And in Revelation, the ten horns are ten kings. It's all the same imagery, and they complement one another. And so what we got to do is go back and see what they said, because they give you very clearly the location, the divisions of the empires, the imagery of what the beasts are, and who they are. And now, historically, we can go back and understand it when we perhaps couldn't have back in their day, of course.
Well, you know, we're quickly running out of time, and I'm glad you're fired up, because
you're
I am, too.
We're running out of time again.
The reality is, Perry, is I think when it says Mystery Babylon, I think the comma is always in the wrong place there. It's actually Mystery Babylon the Great.
Interesting.
You see?
Yeah.
And one of the things that you bring out in your book so well, and I've said this all along, if you go back to the book of Revelation, back of the book of Genesis, you'll see everything in type and shadow and pattern and parallel. You'll see everything that's going to be at the end, because God says, I'm going to tell you the end from the beginning.
Yeah, yeah.
And I have said this publicly on many times, and I said the generals and the nations, the kings that Abraham fought with in the beginning, in other words, the main enemies of Abraham in the book of Genesis, are going to return and be the main enemies in the time of the tribulation.
Mm-hmm.
And you talk about that, and you show that Abraham's first battle,
king of Shinar,
was the king of Shinar. Lo and behold, the king of Shinar, king of Babylon. And it's described, by the way, we don't have time to get into it, but it's in the book, but it's also in the book of Genesis chapter 14, where he describes and he lists all these generals, or all these kings, if you will, that Abraham battled with. And just as the kings that surrounded the Babylonia initiated that first conflict
against Abraham,
Abraham and the Hebrew nation, so it will be these same Islamic kings that will rule this part of the world will be the final places of battle.
Can I show one more thing? This is important. I feel this in my spirit. Revelation chapter 17 is the woman riding the beast, and that is a Babylonian religious system. Chapter 18 is a Babylon that is an economic political system. And scholars have divided that, which can be true. So in other words, if people say the woman is a religious system linked to Rome, you can do that. But at the same time, you can't take chapter 18 and not make it an economic system. So there is a city, a kingdom, and an empire, which is the reformation of Babylon, you see. So I want to make it clear that there are two different, there are two Babylons here that are working together at the same season. So that's important too.
And a perfect text that will tie that in, because we're really all out of time. And it is found in Zechariah chapter 5. A very distinct but yet not very often referred to prophecy, but it is so significant, because Zechariah the prophet sees this sheet come down, and these beings fly wickedness. This woman flies away, and he leaves one area and goes to the final area at the end of time, and it says that he went to a house that was built in the land of Shinar.
Right.
There's only one Babylon, okay? It's on the land of Shinar. And when John saw this Babylon burning so that the smoke lifted up so all the nations could see, folks, Shinar is built just right beneath the surface is this bubbling tar and oil that is there. It all fits. Aren't you glad the Bible fits? If you will take the time to study it, the Bible all fits. Here's our announcer one final time. I want to put my book, Unveiling the Man of Sin, and Perry's book, Unleashing the Beast, into your hands. Will you stand with me? Please. All the information is in this package. Here's our announcer one final time.
Will a coalition of Islamic nations soon form, creating the final kingdom for the Antichrist to emerge? Do Islamic predictions for the end time actually correlate in many ways to what the biblical prophecies declare? In Perry Stone's revised landmark new book, Unleashing the Beast, these questions and many more are answered for you. One chapter in this new book is so controversial that once printed, bookstores refuse to carry it. In addition, Unveiling the Man of Sin, written by Dr. Joe VanKoevering, has become the most talked about book in prophecy circles. In this must-read volume, Joe not only reveals exactly where the Antichrist will emerge from, but he shares the actual name of a man who can fulfill all of the biblical prophecies regarding the Antichrist. And lastly, Joe VanKoevering and Perry Stone have just finished this 90-minute DVD where they answer the many skeptics of how the Islamic world will in fact produce the coming man of sin, the Antichrist himself. Learn who the 12th Imam actually is. Discover why Babylon must rise to world prominence again, and so much more. With this one-of-a-kind new DVD, you can literally sit down with these two scholars and have your prophetic questions answered. All three of these items are now yours for a gift of only $45. Send your gift to God's News, Box 10475, St. Petersburg, Florida, 33733. Or call now, 888-GOD'S-NEWS. That's 888-463-7639. Make that call and start to understand the Islamic beast.
We have really tried to expose the fact that the Antichrist is not a Jew from the tribe of Dan. Bible teaches he's a Gentile. Mm-hmm. He's not really coming from Rome, although the revived Roman Empire is clearly described, and we don't deny that. We're saying that's clearly
and
living.
And the woman on the beast we brought out the other day is a religious system that even the Catholic people believe is linked to Rome. But the ten kings burn her with fire.
Isn't that interesting?
So that they have to be of another belief system than what you see coming out of Rome to have her destroyed. See, that's another point.
Well, here's what I believe, Perry. We've been mentored, and I said this at the very beginning in the outset. We love these men that disagree with us. We respect these men that disagree with us.
Well, we enjoyed that. Many of them at your conference, we get together and have great discussions in the spirit of love, but there are some disagreements.
Many of them are great friends, colleagues, and I've learned from them. But when it comes to some of these key issues, it's almost like they refuse to go and see Islam's part in it. And you say this. Can I quote you, by the way?
Yeah, go ahead.
I want to quote you because, again, Unleashing the Beast is the book we've been featuring.
Well, do you have the quote of the gentleman that says he believed that Islam would be totally destroyed?
I do.
Mention how some people are teaching this, and I think people understand why we're adamant on it, maybe.
Fair enough. We have the critics, and they say, well, there's no way that the Antichrist can be a Muslim, because they see Ezekiel 38 and 39. And Perry, we could name the men. We know them. Mm-hmm. I've seen them on their shows. You have too. And they get right on there and say, you know, Joe's wrong. Perry's wrong. All these people that believe the Antichrist is Muslim is wrong, because Gog and Magog is going to absolutely decimate and destroy the Islamic nations. In fact, this particular man, I'm going to read from his article right here, a man that I know and love, spoke at my prophecy conference, but yet takes me to task. He says, if the Antichrist is a Muslim who's going to rule a Muslim empire in the Middle East during the tribulation, then he's going to rule over an empire that has been reduced to ashes. And, of course, his whole premise is that Ezekiel 38 results in the annihilation of all of the Islamic armies.
And let's say this. Ezekiel 38 and 39 is the war of Gog and Magog.
Gog and Magog.
So he is saying there that this verse in the Bible says that God destroys the armies of Gog and Magog, all but one-sixth of them. And based on that verse of Scripture, he's saying Islam will be destroyed. That's his theory. So thus we are wrong by saying the Antichrist comes out of an Islamic system if the system is destroyed. But it says, you just need to read what I wrote, and I think it will explain to people.
Well, I want to quote Perry, because I couldn't say it any better. You say this, and again, I'm quoting from his book on page 35. It says, after many trips to Israel, I began asking noted prophetic teachers, why is no one explaining the role that Muslims will play in the end time prophecy? Teachers were teaching the significance of Israel and the Jews, along with the Gentile rule common market, but consistently writers and research of eschatology seem to ignore, and that's it, that's what I was saying a moment ago, ignore the importance of the Islamic religion and the Muslims living in the Middle Eastern Europe. Then you say this, one explanation was that Islam would be defeated in the war of Gog and Magog. This cannot be true. That's what Perry says. This cannot be true, since there are presently 52 nations whose population is predominantly Islamic, and the war in Gog and Magog, only 5 major Islamic nations are listed as taking part in this battle. So, Perry, I want to ask these guys, because they say that it's impossible for Muslims to even worship the Antichrist, because they believe that Islam tells them that no man can be God. And so they say that, you know, and I want to ask them this. Okay, are all Muslims around the whole world, around the whole globe, going to die at Gog and Magog? I mean, all of them? I mean, those Islamic guys up in Dearborn, Michigan, are they all going to be destroyed in Gog and Magog too? Or is there going to be some of them still alive in the tribulation period? Because if any of those Muslims are still alive in the tribulation period, they are going to worship the Antichrist as God. They're going to trust him as the Antichrist, because they believe in a global control of the Antichrist. They defeat their own logic. Their logic doesn't even work when you hold their fire.
Okay.
Feet to the fire.
Let's go to the war of Gog and Magog for a minute. And you mentioned the nations. We've got basically Persia, we've got Ethiopia, Libya,
right?
Tagarma, and the North Quarters. Now, we have a series of Islamic nations that will attack Israel under the direction of what they believe to be those southern Russian states, or even Russia itself. That's established by everyone. 1/6 of them will remain, while 5/6 of them will be destroyed. That's an established fact. But we have to keep in mind there's over 50-some Islamic nations in the earth. Now, let me ask you something. Indonesia, for example, is the world's largest Islamic country. They are not in this war.
Mm-mm.
We could go into Europe and name Germany and France that have 6 million, Muslims in France. They're not involved in this war.
Nope.
Britain and England, they're not involved in this war. In fact,
Babylon, Perry, is not involved in this war.
No, you don't see. What's interesting? Who's
Iraq.
Missing? You don't see Syria in that war, and you don't see Egypt in that war. They're not mentioned by name.
Right.
Now, this is important for people to understand. In that same passage, it mentions burning, waiting 7 months to bury the corpses and 7 years to burn the weapons. I believe that 7 years of burning the weapons is a clue to the Antichrist treaty of 7 years mentioned in Daniel 9:27. Israel will make an agreement with the remaining Islamic nations, and the one nation that will be at the forefront after Persia is messed up is Iraq. And this Mahdi, this leader, will rise. In fact, he can rise quickly. Yeah, he will use, the Islamic belief to ride his horse on the scene with the Islamic belief, is my opinion.
There you go.
All right, now, that gives the...
They'll be quick to make peace want peace with Israel. Right now,
after
they're not, they're going to be really eager to make peace.
And
I agree.
And here's the key. It appears that the nations, part of this 7 years, the nations will demand Israel to disarm. Because I never understood, how could the Antichrist take over Israel with the military they've got? Israel will be forced by the UN, by Europe, and everybody else to disarm by the remaining Islamic nations, and it may even be oil. The Bible says the Antichrist will be over the fattest places of the province, and that's the oil. And if he's over the oil, he can manipulate and blackmail entire nations. And that will give the Antichrist and his armies 42 months to arm themselves and be able at that point to be the main military source in that part of Europe and the Middle East. And so when people say, and I've met preachers that are good men that love God, but we differ here. And let me say something. I don't fall out with people because I differ.
Right.
And you need
right.
to understand, Joe and I are passionate about what we teach, but we don't fall out with anybody that
we
differs
with us. We
love
these men that disagree with us.
We fellowship.
Still continue to
learn from them.
We have conferences together.
Oh, yeah, we rap together, and then we go out and get a pizza. You know what I'm saying? So we don't fall out with them because we're trying to do like everyone else, study the Scripture to see what the Scripture says, you know. But you cannot say that Islam will be destroyed in the Gog and Magog battle when you only have a certain listing of nations that are destroyed. Then you've got all... So in my opinion, what happens is Israel's victory causes these nations to reorganize and form this caliph. Think about it. Now, stop and think. Persia's destroyed, okay? What happens is you have a void. So you have to have one nation, which will be Iraq, which will organize... Remember, Damascus is destroyed too somewhere, probably before this. So they're going to take Syria and Lebanon, and they're going to take Persia, probably Afghanistan, Pakistan, and they're going to reunite it under one major force that Israel will never again be able to defeat the Islamic world.
That's something.
That's where I see this whole thing coming to. And of course, the Palestinian issue, which is the land for peace issue, there's no question that will be another area which this particular man that we're talking about will be able to have popularity when he goes into Israel and takes half of the city back under Islamic control, which we now know Jerusalem is an undivided city, Jewish capital. But when this man goes into there, Zechariah says half the city will go into captivity. The women will be ravished. The houses rifled. And so we see that that's what will make him the hero, is by being able to liberate the Temple Mount, the Jewish presence, the two witnesses, all this link in the book of Revelation, and to remove them out of the presence of Islam's third holiest site, which is Jerusalem. And I think that's what makes him worshipped, why people worship him.
And greatly said. And again, to capsulize this before we go to our break right now and return in just a moment, again, I want to reiterate, next time you hear some prophecy preacher, and when you hear him, I already know that man. He's a personal friend, okay? I mean, I love him. Like Perry said, we get along great with him. But here's where we differ. They say that somehow this Gog and Magog war is going to so decimate all of Islam. And we're trying to tell you that is not the case. That is a fallacy. That is that is something that is really being forced into the Scriptures instead of reading the Scriptures. That is something to try to make their theory of a European Antichrist emerge.
Right.
Did I say that right?
I think that's right. And I think what people have to do is what I have done over the years. I said to somebody, I knew who the Antichrist was when I was 19 and preached on him until they shot him 2 weeks later and I had to change my theory. You just have to be willing when light comes that really shows you is to be able to say, you know what, we didn't have all the understanding. It's just like people who fight the rapture.
Yeah.
They get our series on the rapture and they say, I never heard this. I didn't know that. Well, see, it helps them to understand when you have more knowledge.
Yeah.
So we have to be willing when we say we have more knowledge and understanding, you know, to make adjustments on perhaps what we believe.
And that's why Perry and I write books, and that's why we're going to have our announcer come and put these tools in your hands, because really, we're just scratching the surface. We're trying to really hit a few highlights, capture some people's attention. These ministry tools, yes, when you make that call, first and foremost, it helps us stay on the air. It keeps this broadcast coming into your home or wherever you're watching us. But more importantly, it gives you the information. It arms you with the knowledge that you have. Here's our announcer. One more time. Will you please make that call? Stand with me. Thank you.
Will a coalition of Islamic nations soon form, creating the final kingdom for the Antichrist to emerge? Do Islamic predictions for the end time actually correlate in many ways to what the biblical prophecies declare? In Perry Stone's revised landmark new book, Unleashing the Beast, these questions and many more are answered for you. One chapter in this new book is so controversial that once printed, bookstores refuse to carry it. In addition, Unveiling the Man of Sin, written by Dr. Joe VanKoevering, has become the most talked about book in prophecy circles. In this must-read volume, Joe not only reveals exactly where the Antichrist will emerge from, but he shares the actual name of a man who can fulfill all of the biblical prophecies regarding the Antichrist. And lastly, Joe VanKoevering and Perry Stone have just finished this 90-minute DVD where they answer the many skeptics of how the Islamic world will in fact produce the coming man of sin, the Antichrist himself. Learn who the 12th Imam actually is. Discover why Babylon must rise to world prominence again, and so much more. With this one-of-a-kind new DVD, you can literally sit down with these two scholars and have your prophetic questions answered. All three of these items are now yours for a gift of only $45. Send your gift to God's News, Box 10475, St. Petersburg, Florida, 33733. Or call now, 888-GOD'S-NEWS. That's 888-463-7639. Make that call and start to understand the Islamic beast.
Welcome back. Thank you for making that call. Perry and I have labored these few weeks to try to share as much with you as we can. There's just no way to do it. So you need to get the additional information. Perry, one of the things that that you mentioned at the very outset when we just started this discussion a number of weeks ago was when you saw in Revelation 20. We've all known it. Mm-hmm. When we were both younger men, our mentors taught us that, you know, this king of Europe that's going to be the Antichrist, some Jew from the tribe of Dan, he's going to have millions and millions of guillotines. And, you know, those guillotines are going to take and chop people's heads off. Not even realizing, not even thinking at the time. And listen, these men still teach that, by the way. Mm-hmm. Some of these men that I know and love dearly, mm-hmm. that are now up in years, like mm-hmm. we're all getting up in years, but the fact is they still publicly proclaim guillotines. Perry, you and I absolutely no longer believe that at all. Not that the Antichrist couldn't use a guillotine, but when it talks in Revelation 20 about those who refuse to receive the mark. And I want to give this verse. Look at this. Revelation 20 and verse 4 says, "And I saw thrones, mm-hmm. and they that sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, of which had not worshipped the beast, mm-hmm. neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or on their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Here mm-hmm. is identified the group of what we call the tribulation saints, the tribulation mm-hmm. martyrs, whatever term you want to use, both are appropriate. They came to faith, they trusted in Christ, and they refused to take the mark. They refused to bow and worship this image of this beast and declare that this man was God and serve this false God. And as a result, they lost their heads." Mm-hmm. Now, Perry, you have a whole chapter in your book on it. I have, you know, a whole part of a chapter in my book. This is the sword of Islam, is it not?
Well, let me say this, because this is very, very important for people to understand this, that in the time of the Roman Empire, Paul was beheaded. And there were other people that were beheaded by the Roman system. So some people try to say that this alludes to back in that day. And here we go back again to preterism, you know. Well, you know, that was the beheadings happened in the 60, 70 AD, etc. However, this indicates that this beast system, because you do not worship the beast, you have nothing to do with the beast, he kills people by beheading. Now, in different religions, I hate to say this, it's almost embarrassing to say that religions kill people, but they have through history. But in different religions, they kill people who either don't believe in them or attack them or whatever. They kill them different ways. One of the ways that Islam unequivocally deals with its the people that they kill is by beheading. Now, we would have never thought about this, Joe, until we had a war in Iraq and a war in Afghanistan, where there it was, people being captured and being beheaded by members of the Taliban. So in other words, what we've got to see here is that this is another clue to
another clue.
This
That's
link.
It.
It's just a clue to this Islamic link
yep.
of the Antichrist coming out of this background that we've been talking about, because
yep.
Islam, it's called the sword of Islam. And
yep.
what is interesting is when you begin to really study the prophecies of the Bible, and you begin to study the end time, you discover that very, very clearly that Islam teaches it is okay to behead people under certain conditions, especially infidels.
Well, I'm going to give the verses in
okay.
just a moment from
yeah.
the Quran, because you list them in your book, but let me make this clear. I'm quoting from an Islamic source, an Islamic scholar, Muhammad himself, the founder of Islam, practiced beheading. It goes back to its very beginning. I'm quoting, "Abdullah cut off Abba Hakam's head and carried it to his master. The head of the enemy of Allah," exclaimed Muhammad joyously. "Allah, there is no other God but He. Yea, there is no other," responded Abdullah as he cast the severed head. I don't mean to be gross, but this is what it says. Cast the severed head at the Prophet, meaning Muhammad's feet. "It is more acceptable to me," cried Muhammad, hardly able to contain his joy, "than the choicest camel of all Arabia." And there's the end of the quote. All of Muhammad's disciples beheaded. Hundreds of examples could be given and cited from the Hadith and Muslim poetry, both ancient and modern history. People say, well, do they still do this today? This is just the few radicals. Listen, in the past 2 decades, in Saudi Arabia alone, they have beheaded or decapitated at least 1,100 people. Hear what I just said. Legally, according to Sharia law, decapitated 1,100 people in the past 20 years for alleged crimes ranging from drug running to witchcraft to apostasy. In 2003 alone, the Saudi government beheaded 52 men and one woman. A condemned convict is brought into the courtyard, hands tied, forced to bow before an executioner who swings a huge sword amid cries from onlookers of Allah Akbar, meaning God is greater. Folks, this is documented. Wow. in the Quran. Surah 8:12 says, therefore strike off their heads, strike off every fingertip of them, because they acted aversely to Allah. Surah 4:8 says, seize them and slay them wherever you find them. And here it is in Surah 47, when you meet the unbelievers, and that's what you just referred to, the infidels.
Yeah. Yeah.
When you meet the unbelievers in the battlefield, strike off their heads. And when you have laid them low, bind your captives firmly. There's only one religion in the world whose religious book and traditions of their religion from their founder on believe and practice the act of beheading, and it is the religion of Islam.
Mm-hmm. Now, another thing you have to point out, Joe, when you're talking about this, is that not only historically was that the method of execution, it is today the method of execution in like Saudi Arabia, for example, or Islamic countries. But you have to keep something else in mind. They teach, when I say they, I'm talking about Muslims teach, that one of the things that will happen at the end of days when the Mahdi rises is that he will tear down the cross and kill the swine, which is the Jews. And the way you kill them is by the sword, okay? And there's really, really, Joe, to be very honest with you, there is no way you can look at Revelation 20 in light with what we've been teaching people and not see that this is not a... here's how the Antichrist was taught when I was growing up. There'll be this great man of peace, and the world will swoon after him, and he will make peace. Okay, you see him making peace, and then over here you see him chopping people's heads off. Now, I said, okay, what's the deal here? This contradicts. In Revelation 13, it says about twice, and it may say it three times throughout the book, who can make,
yes,
say it,
war.
War,
exactly,
against the beast. This man signs an agreement,
oh,
to,
yeah,
make peace with many nations.
Absolutely.
But he comes fighting, slaying, mm-hmm, killing, mm-hmm, wounding. He comes as a warrior.
And the peace is a false peace,
the
by
peace
the way.
Is a, yeah.
The peace that's used in the word itself is not shalom. It's a different Hebrew word.
Yeah,
you bring,
yeah,
this out in your book, and,
yeah,
I just did a podcast where I taught on this as well, because,
uh-huh,
I studied it out myself from the original word there from the book of Daniel. And the word literally means security.
He promises the Jews,
right,
security, not the peace of shalom, the peace,
right,
the prosperity, the peace. But he says, we will give you security if you will come into an agreement with us.
It's a false peace.
Exactly. Exactly.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
It's a forced peace.
Yeah.
And it's, and again, it's the sword of Islam, folks. It's the same spirit. It's the same spirit that you see at work among these religious zealots in Islam.
Yeah, yeah. And so, once again, if we go back to what we said, the very first program that you have this teaching about a man called the Mahdi. He appears on a white horse. He beheads those who differ with him. He and Jesus appear together, and they go to the city of Jerusalem, where they conquer the Jewish people. They destroy the cross. They teach that this Jesus, when he appears, will say he's not the Son of God, that he lied. That's all in their teaching. It fits the imagery, and I challenge you to read this. It fits the imagery of Revelation chapter 13, verses 1 through 4. In Revelation chapter 13, the false prophet of verses 11 through about verse 13. So you have two people coming, and oddly enough, it fits the imagery of the Antichrist and the false prophet. And so I think the world is aligning itself into camps to line up for the seventh empire, which is more of a global empire, which will be swallowed up by an eighth empire, which is an Islamic empire of Bible prophecy. And when we wrote the book, Unleashing the Beast, that Joe's going to make available in a moment, we totally rewrote it. This book was under contract to go in bookstores. Chapter 11, they refused to take it because of chapter 11. And I'm not even going to tell you what's in that chapter. It's a powerful expose that'll blow your mind, especially if you live in North America. But we go into detail about that. And so Joe's making that available. And if you have a lot of questions, I say this will answer a lot of the questions for you.
Well, we're all out of time, Pierre. I can hardly believe it. for anyone that's watching right now, and you're not right with Jesus.
Yes.
I believe there's someone, Perry, watching us right now, and there was a day when they walked with the Lord. There was a time when you were in fellowship with Him, you walked in the light, you loved the Scriptures. But if you were honest right now, you know your heart has grown cold, and you've not been living for the Lord, and you've not even been talking to Him. You've not been reading your Bible, and something captured your attention today. You can come back to your faith again. You can find your faith again. Will you pray this prayer with me? If you've walked with the Lord, or maybe you've never, and this is the very first time you've ever said yes to Jesus, just pray this simple prayer and mean it with all of your heart. The Holy Spirit is right here to woo you and draw you and make you new. I'm telling you, you can be new right now. Pray this prayer and mean it.
Praise
God in heaven, be merciful to me, a sinner. Jesus, I do believe in you. Jesus, I trust you right now. I believe you shed your blood for me. Jesus, forgive me. Cleanse me. Come into my heart. Keep me ready for your coming, I pray. Amen. If you just prayed that prayer with me, welcome to the family of God. Welcome to the kingdom of God. There's going to be an address up, and I just ask you to sit down and write me and say, I prayed with that guy with all the white hair, that guy VanKoevering on television. Now, for those of you who are viewers and partners and you've already known the Lord, I trust that you've enjoyed this time. Perry, thank you again for being with us.
I always enjoy it.
This book, you must have. Absolutely. Perry just told you why the bookstores are not even cold in it. My book, Unveiling the Man of Sin. This entire package, here's our announcer one final time. This is the final time. Will you make that call? Stand with us in Jesus' name.
Will a coalition of Islamic nations soon form, creating the final kingdom for the Antichrist to emerge? Do Islamic predictions for the end time actually correlate in many ways to what the biblical prophecies declare? In Perry Stone's revised landmark new book, Unleashing the Beast, these questions and many more are answered for you. One chapter in this new book is so controversial that once printed, bookstores refuse to carry it. In addition, Unveiling the Man of Sin, written by Dr. Joe VanKoevering, has become the most talked about book in prophecy circles. In this must-read volume, Joe not only reveals exactly where the Antichrist will emerge from, but he shares the actual name of a man who can fulfill all of the biblical prophecies regarding the Antichrist. And lastly, Joe VanKoevering and Perry Stone have just finished this 90-minute DVD where they answer the many skeptics of how the Islamic world will in fact produce the coming Man of Sin, the Antichrist himself. Learn who the 12th Imam actually is. Discover why Babylon must rise to world prominence again, and so much more. With this one-of-a-kind new DVD, you can literally sit down with these two scholars and have your prophetic questions answered. All three of these items are now yours for a gift of only $45. Send your gift to God's News, Box 10475, St. Petersburg, Florida, 33733. Or call now, 888-GOD'S-NEWS. That's 888-463-7639. Make that call and start to understand the Islamic beast.
Thank you for being my partner. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for standing with me to keep this prophetic voice strong. Till next week, I remind you once again of the words of Jesus. He said, "Be ye therefore ready also, for in such an hour as ye think not, the Son of Man cometh."